My name is Angela Larsen, and I'm a PhD student here at UNCG. My specific project is looking at how individual behaviors of cotton rats are impacting or driving the changes that we see at population levels and also community structure of rodents. So cotton rats are a type of rat that is wild, and they're native to a lot of the southeast part of the United States. For my research, I actually go to a field site that's located in Mississippi. When we set our traps, we set them in the evening and we put a little bit of seed in there. It's not necessarily used as bait, but it does provide a food source for them when they're actually in the trap. We leave those traps open all night in the field, and the rodent will come into the trap and they go to the back of the trap before the trap door closes, so that rodent is all the way in the trap and not going to be harmed at all by the trap itself. We come back in the mornings to check our traps, and we take out any rodent that was captured. And when we're actually processing them, we can look at what species it is. We can also ear tag it, and so that's just like getting an ear piercing that you might have. So we actually have unique numbers on each of those ear tags so we can know what the individual is. So all of that processing actually happens within minutes, and by the time that we have everything recorded, we just simply release the rodent right where it was caught, and it goes off and does its normal daily routine. So my funding comes from a lot of different sources. I actually came into this project under a large grant that was put through by NCASI Weyerhaeuser, which is a private forest company that we work with, and they're really interested in sustaining wildlife biodiversity. And one of the things that they're interested right now in is trying to plant switchgrass into their pine plantations that they already have established. So switchgrass can be harvested every year, and it can be converted into a biofuel that can then be used. So this is reducing the amount or necessary use of any kind of fossil fuel that you normally would fuel a lot of like cars with. It's also a native grass to most of the southeast of the US. And so by planting it, you're not introducing any kind of non-native species or anything that's going to take over and become invasive. And what we want to know, or what they want to know, is this planting of switchgrass going to negatively impact biodiversity overall? And one of the main reasons that I'm doing my research is I can look at biodiversity on a rodent level relatively easily by doing the actual research that I'm doing. And there's other collaborators that are working with us from places like Mississippi State that are looking at the bird diversity, and there's other people who are looking more into the soils and vegetation. So they are looking at this on a very broad level, and I am just one small project as part of this really large collaborative study that's going on between multiple universities as well as private forest companies. I recently got an EPA STAR fellowship, and so EPA is also a major funder source of this project. So what that does is allow me to not have to teach for a teaching assistantship. It actually gives me a stipend so I can really focus on my research. And the most recent one that I got was the Robert R. Bryden grant, and that was through North Carolina Academy of Science. And that's a grant that's given to a graduate student for their research expenses. So that grant in particular will be going towards transmitters that I have to buy. The transmitters are basically put into little collars that are then put onto the cotton rats, so I can follow individual cotton rats throughout the season. And so what that allows me to do is find their nest sites and also estimate their home ranges. So far what's kind of interesting to me is we're actually not seeing differences among our treatments of planting switchgrass, not planting switchgrass, or planting switchgrass in pine plantations. And so part of the reason I'm adding the individual behavior data into this is because we want to understand if we're not seeing differences because there's such a time delay up to those population and community levels. And if that's the case, we'll be able to capture those changes at the individual level first. That's kind of the next step going forward. We're going to be looking at modeling from individual level up to population and community level, and try to predict and simulate those differences.